Now, let's begin with some what I call specific shortcuts. There's general shortcuts, there's specific shortcuts. What is a specialized or specific shortcut? I mean a shortcut which will get you to the answer of some operation more quickly. That's the good news. The bad news is it only works for a very limited number of problems or numbers. For example, there is a shortcut that we can use for the squares of two-digit numbers that end in a 5. 15, 25, 35, 45, all the way up to 95. Now, if you are not allowing your kids to use calculators, and I'm all for you there, but if you're not going to allow them to use calculators, and if they have to multiply 65 times 65, you leave them no choice. This is what you're telling them to do. I guarantee you one thing, kids from Singapore don't do that, or any of those other countries that really beat up on us in that mental competition. In fact, that's not mental competition anyway. That's written. Can't do that in that competition. If we had any of these problems on that mental competition test, here's what we would be expected to do. 4,225, 9,025, 1,225, 7,225, 2,025, 225. I didn't have any of those memorized. I just did them. I actually computed them as I was going through them. Now, first you say, oh, wow, I'm starting to catch on with this guy. This guy is one of those geniuses. I've seen a few of them on TV. No, I'm afraid not. I'm as dumb as a stick. But that's not so bad, because if I was a genius and if I did have all these great powers to square five-digit numbers in my head, and there are some people that can do that, you know what would happen? At the end of the hour, you'd be walking out this door here saying, wow, am I glad I came to listen to this guy. He was really entertaining. Boy, can he do the things with numbers. But all of a sudden, reality would set in, and you'd start to say, well, wait a second, though. I'm no better off than I was when I walked in on him. Sure, he entertained me, but I didn't learn anything. I don't have a brain like his. Guess what? We don't have that situation. You do have a brain like mine, probably a whole lot better. So you can do this, too. And I certainly hope when you walk out of the room today, you will never, ever take a two-digit number ending in 5 and go through this nonsense. Now, question is, however, what did I do? My suggestion in trying to determine how I came up with the answers quickly is to take all these answers, break them up into first half and second half. That's going to give you the clues. Now, that being the case, who's the first person who can raise their hand? You don't have to give me an explanation right now, but who can raise their hand and tell me what the square of this number is? Yes?
2125.
I'm sorry?
2125.
2125? No. Yes?
5625.
5625, she says. Let's see. First of all, we noticed that all of them end in 25. That's right. And so 75 squared is also going to end in 25. Now, the question is, what about the first half? Well, you'll find that with every one of these, you get the first half of the answer by taking the first digit, like the 6, multiply it times the number that normally follows it in rotation. After a 6 comes a 7. 6 times 7 is 42, or in the case of 75, what comes after a 7? An 8. 7 times 8, 56. You are correct. And you know, in this little format that we have here, I got to let you know, you're not playing with kids here. We have prizes. You like orange, red, or blue?
Red.
The red?
Yeah.
Okay, there you go. All right. See that? Don't you wish you would have gotten that one right?
Yeah.
But there may be more for you, so hang on. Okay. Isn't this great? So we have about 9 numbers here. You can get them instantaneously. You saw how fast I was, as fast as I could write them down. So you never want to have to do this. You show this to the kids, especially a kid who's below average. Here's some motivation for memorizing the multiplication tables. Say, hey, kid, if you know that 6 times 7 is 42, man, you can find 65 squared just like that. That's all you need, is an understanding and knowledge of your multiplication facts. And then, of course, I always try to give them a little further motivation. I say, hey, you're just learning this today. You know what you do now? You go home tonight, get a hold of Mom and Pop. Say, Pop, I challenge you for a dollar. I'll let Mom call out a 2-digit number that ends in 5. You can use paper and pencil, Pop, or you can use a calculator. I don't care which one. Mom's going to call out a 2-digit number. I don't know which one it is. Let's see which one of us can call out the correct answer the soonest. The kid's going to beat Pop every time if he uses paper and pencil. Or worse still, oh, I'm going to use my calculator here. Here, let's see. Take the cover off. Hit the on button. Hit the whatever we're doing, 6, and then the 5, and either use the exponent or use multiplication times 6, 5, whichever way you want to do it. And not only that, but then Pop finally gets an answer, and if we wanted to write it down, now he still has to put the calculator down, he has to pick up his pen, he has to go over and write down the answer. Oh my goodness, that's the Middle Ages type of calculations. Now, I know what you're asking. You're saying, hey, I like that. I like that. Give me more. And I know what you're probably thinking. You're saying, hey, that's fine for a number that ends in 5, but gee, what would you do if you had numbers that began with a 5? What would you do then? Well, if you had, and of course, we've only got about 10 of them, don't we? So again, it's a specialized method. It's a great method, but it only works for about 10 numbers. But if you want to take the squares of any of these numbers, just write them down. 2,916, 2,601, 3,249, 3,481, 2,809, 3,364. Okay, how did I get that? Again, my suggestion is split the number down into 2 parts, and that's going to give you the little technique. The little technique that the kids from Singapore use in Korea and Japan and Hong Kong and Belgium and Czechoslovakia. Maybe not the kids from the U.S., or maybe they do use them, but maybe they don't come up with the answer quite as quickly. Anybody want to venture a try? Oh, I'm sorry, I didn't even ask a number. Let's try, how about, yeah, let's go with 56 squared. What would 56 squared be? 31, yes.
31,
she says 31, 36. Let's see if she's right. First of all, she notices that with all these others, the last 2 digits are the square of the units digit. 4 squared is 16. 1 squared is 0, 1. If it's a single digit, you have to put a 0 in front of it. So she says, well, 6 squared then would be 36. Then the question is, how did she get the first half? And you got the first half by? That's exactly right. Of course, since this only works for numbers that begin with a 5, you could actually even make the explanation shorter by just saying, take 25 and add it to the number next door. So 25 added to 4, 25 added to 1, 25 added to 6 gives us the 31. Okay? Blue or orange?
Orange.
Alrighty, very good. Okay, now, at this point, being defined teachers that you are, I'm sure a lot of people are asking this question, and this is an excellent question. You're saying, yeah, it's a real nice shortcut, but is this a magic trick? I mean, how do we know it's always going to work? You can test out the 10 problems or so, but is that really a way of proving this? Here's how we prove it with either of those 2 methods that I've shown you now for numbers that end in a 5 or begin with a 5. The proof would look something like this. It doesn't require any more knowledge than what you would have learn in an Algebra 1 course. Let's just take the numbers that end in 5. Any two-digit number ending in 5 could be written as 10t plus 5. When you square that binomial, we get this trinomial. If you take the first two terms, factor out 100t, we get 100t times t plus 1 plus 25. Let's use our commutative property, flip this around a little bit. And we get t times t plus 1 times 100 plus 25. In other words, what we're learning here is that the square of any two-digit number will always equal the tens digit, like here's an example with the 85, the tens digit 8, times t plus 1, that's 8 plus 1 or 9, 8 times 9, that's 72, times 100, 7200, plus 25 every time. So 7225. And you've got a similar type of derivation here or proof for a number that begins with a 5. Of course, I know what you're saying. You're saying, you're making yourself look good here with these numbers that begin or end with a 5. How about a real tough one? How about something like something that begins with a 9? Yeah, now there's a tough one. How would you do that, huh? Okay, the situation is just a tiny bit different. Here's what we do. Once again, there's going to be a first half and a second half to the problem. Here's what you do. It takes a little preliminary step. The preliminary step, which you can do in your head, of course, subtract a given number, let's take 97, subtract a number from 100. Okay, it's 3, right? I wouldn't normally write this down, but just so we can sort of see it, it's the first time perhaps you are seeing it, so that's why I write it down. So you take that little number, which represents the difference between the number and 100. Now, to get the first half of the answer, subtract that little number 3 from the given number. 3 from 97, 94. That's easy, isn't it? And the second thing we do is we take that little number and we square it. 3 squared is 9, which we write as 09. We're finished. That's pretty nice.